We have chosen a spectacular location for a very special dig. It's Time Team's 30th birthday, and we are celebrating in style.
University. I just can't put up a tent.
It's not even my tent.
The fields where we've set up camp are farmed by the family of our very own Derek Pittman, who's found lots of pieces of Roman pottery over the years. So in 2021, he and Lawrence decided to do some geophys and a small excavation. But instead of a Roman villa, they found two Iron Age burials.
Iron Age burials in this part of Dorset rarely survive in these soils. So we've got a golden opportunity to investigate what could be a rare Iron Age cemetery site, and maybe even find out where these people were living and how they were living.
And also to find out something about that Roman material as well. And we've just got 3 days to do it. The farm is on the Isle of Purbeck in Dorset. During the Iron Age, it was inhabited by the Duotriges, who lived here for centuries before and after the Roman invasion in AD 43. John's already managed to complete a geophysical survey of the fields, which are overlooked by the Purbeck Ridge, studded with prehistoric barrows and earthworks and the impressive medieval ruins of Corfe Castle. To the north of the site is Poole Harbour, which the Romans used during the invasion and has been an important trade route throughout history and prehistory. But on the morning of day one, this stunning location is obscured by thick fog.
And you had no idea that there were Iron Age burials here, is that true?
Absolutely no idea. We were here looking for structural evidence, Roman buildings perhaps, industrial material. What we didn't expect was to dig down a bit deeper and find two Iron Age burials. This soil just doesn't preserve bone well, so it was a real surprise to see these two here.
And what are the sorts of dates that we're looking at?
So we've got a carbon date that basically puts it at zero plus or minus a few years, which means these individuals were living right at the end of late Iron Age Britain, just before the Romans came. In fact, their descendants, their offspring, probably saw the transition to Roman Britain.
Amazing. And what does the geophys tell us, John?
Well, there's just so much going on. Ignore the large anomalies, those are pipelines. But we've got a mass of enclosures spread over such a large area. Now, this is where you put the original trench in, and that seems to be set within this enclosure. More enclosures beyond, then a whole series of pits. Straight linear features, could those be Roman?
And so what would the strategy be then with such a rich site?
Well, we know we've got to start with our initial trench. I think we've got to expand that. We've got to understand the context it's in. So we only did a 5x1. So we're going to grow that, understand the relationship to this enclosure that's found here, which, I mean, it's pretty interesting, isn't it, John, that enclosure?
Well, when I first saw it, I thought it was a banjo.
What's a banjo?
Oh, that's a classic Middle Iron Age site. The clue's in the name. It's shaped like a banjo. You've got a big circular top bit in the north with what looks to be an avenue coming up into
There's
it.
There's the avenue. There's mixed views about how they were used. I mean, they could have been high status, some people have argued. Others have said they're just cattle enclosures. Yeah. So the cattle would be pulled in this way. But you've got the burials inside, which makes it a bit confusing.
Exactly. So I think we need to expand on where we were first, and we want to understand the purpose of the site. Are there more burials? And what's its relationship to the age of phasing to that ditch?
So as the sun begins to break through the lingering morning mist, we're getting ready to place trench one.
So these pegs are the footprints of your evaluation trench, is that right, Harry?
John Millward and Harry Manley from Bournemouth University worked with Derek and Lawrence on the original dig and have joined Matt to find and expand the 2021 trench. Our initial task is to find out how the first century burials and the possible kiln they found relate to the large enclosure ditch on the geophys.
It's very soft soil, isn't it? So I think we'll have to be careful. We'll just take the top off with the machine and then as little as possible, really. And then it's going to be hand digging really down to this level here, isn't it?
The first thing the 2021 trench revealed was a medieval post pad, about a foot above the possible kiln. So we're expecting to have centuries of complicated archaeology to untangle before we get to the Roman or Iron Age levels.
Perfect. Got our first find.
First find, pottery. Ooh, what's that? It's not, it's, well.
It's orange on the inside, which is interesting.
So. Yeah, I thought it was black burnishware, but it's not, is it?
It kind of fools you. On that side, you think, oh, maybe it's black burnishware. Turn over, that's probably some form of medieval pottery. So
right, okay.
Yeah, so actually in the right kind of layers, because we found that medieval post pad at around 30 to 40 centimetres, so we're getting down to that level. So
that's great.
I think, yeah, the dig has taken off to a good level now. You
Perfect.
Can just see these bits of orange here, so we're getting fragments, flecks of bioturbated material, some inorganics in there. So we're just coming down below that plough soil now, aren't we?
Yeah.
So we're getting down to the right level. I keep thinking I'm seeing shale here as well, which is exciting. But
what is that? What? That's not shale, is it?
No, that's probably a bit more prehistoric pottery, actually.
Oh, right.
But that's a fragment, so that's been kicked around in the soil for a long time.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we're getting a good mix now. But that's lovely, that is.
Yeah.
That's probably just sat on that surface for 600, 700 years.
Okay, do you get that, John? Yeah. Fire up.
It's looking promising in Trench 1. But before we can put our second trench in, our metal detectorist team is scanning the area for small finds. The 2021 team thought they could see evidence of another skeleton near the two that they lifted, so we're taking things slowly.
It's reassuring that we've been able to relocate our trench, actually.
We're definitely in the right place.
Yeah. We should begin to see where that trench widens out slightly, and that's where we're getting the skeleton. Right. So, yeah, this is really positive.
And in the dome, Martin Smith has laid out the burials so that he and Jackie can re-examine them. The carbon date was taken from the later burial, which cut through the smaller one underneath.
Well, I'm quite surprised, actually, that they are this well-preserved, because this is heathland, it's really acid soils. So, tell me what we've got here.
Well, what we have is, firstly, a small and lightly built individual. Most of the long bones, well, all of the long bones, in fact, we can see are the ends are fused, so that person has finished growing, except what's really of interest is these two bones here.
So this is the clavicle or the collarbone. And we can see, yes, yeah, that's not fused there, is it?
So this is suggesting that this is more likely this person's in their early 20s.
Their early 20s. And that's the last bone to fuse, and after that it's all downhill, as it were.
That's the finished
growing. So I'm guessing it really is female.
Absolutely. So if we look at aspects of the pelvic bones, we can see this curve here. This is what we call the greater sciatic notch. That's got a form that we tend to see in female individuals. We've taken some
it's
measurements.
Quite wide. It's wide rather than narrow. So it's opening up that pelvic girdle. And the skull also?
Well, if we look at the brow ridges or the lack of them, we can see this person's got a very smooth forehead. And again, that's the sort of form that we would tend to see in female individuals.
Yeah.
So we've got lots of indicators.
And that's sharp as well, isn't it? The margin of the orbit is very sharp.
Absolutely.
This woman was, well, we'd say gracile, but petite.
Absolutely.
I mean, I have never seen a collarbone quite that lightly built.
Absolutely. They're really slender, aren't they?
Yeah.
It's really quite surprising. In fact, that's the sort of normal size and shape you would see in a child.
Yes, yeah. Right, so this is our other one. This is the one that originally, I think when you took a rapid scan of it, you thought might be male, but it's still... That's tiny, but this is still really quite small.
Absolutely. Both of these individuals come out as very, very small by our standards, something like 4'11", 5' nothing.
Oh, Clemson, that is actually below what we, for this period, we would expect to be an average. And I think, actually, it's probably one of the smallest pair of individuals I've seen generally from this period.
And the question was, what could this actually be? A small, gracile, relatively lightly built male.
Yeah. And I can see how, if we look at that greater sciatic notch again that we saw over the other side, that actually looks fairly tight, but that one looks wider to me.
That's it. Now we've
that
reconstructed
looks feminine,
them.
Yeah. And looking at bits of the skull also, although comparatively speaking, this looks heftier Absolutely. And more robust, they still look quite feminine. Now we've had a better look at it, I think it's more likely female.
I think I'd agree.
Yeah, but what about age?
This person's certainly a little bit older. This joint here, called the auricular surface, this is where the pelvic bones join onto the spine, and that deteriorates as people are getting older.
Yeah.
And we can see that the degree of deterioration there is telling us that this person is certainly a little bit older, into the 30s, maybe early 40s is a guess.
Yeah.
We can look at the spine. We're not seeing much in terms of deterioration on this spine, in terms of sort of arthritic changes that people pick up as they get older. So that suggests this person isn't of hugely advanced age, but they're certainly older than individual number one.
And the tooth wear's heavier as well than it is with the other one.
So we have two women buried on top of each other in the Duotrigian tradition, in a flex position. And we know that the younger woman died sometime before the older. Further DNA analysis might tell us whether they were related, but we know at least one was buried between 50 BC and 50 AD. And we're already getting pottery dating to a similar period in Trench 1.
Nice piece, first century. Acute angled burnished line lattice decoration, but I can't tell whether it's pre or post-conquest.
Okay.
I suspect it's post.
Yeah, okay.
It's reasonably well-fired, reasonably hard.
And now, we're beginning to see the first signs of a building.
So yeah, we've got one, two, three, there.
Another one coming up there as well.
Yeah, so I would say it could be another one of the post pad type features, couldn't it?
Yeah, whether it's part of the same structure or whether it's just another structure which is close by, unsure, but that's really nice because they're all together and they seem to be forming a coherent unit, then probably we can say it's not just a random scatter of stone, it's actually forming something, so that's really nice.
Is that one is actually one underneath there as well.
Okay.
And your first post pad, your other earlier post pad was...
It was about 4 metres away, Matt, approximately here, and around the same depth as well, which is interesting. So again, that suggests it's contemporary.
We're just coming down onto the top of it now, aren't we? So...
And just by the post pads is another piece of Romano British pottery.
Ideally, we want to find some of this amongst the stones.
Wedged in
So maybe the post holes are from a building that stood here at the same time as our Iron Age women were living here. The story of their settlement, which we hope to uncover over the next 3 days, will feed into a wider investigation into the Duotrigas that Miles Russell has been leading at Bournemouth University for 15 years.
I suppose it's the hill forts that dominate discussion of Iron Age Dorset.
Yes.
They are so massive, they're so impressive and monumental, but they seem to be going out of use by about 100 BC. So it's almost a century and a half before the Romans arrive. And what we're missing is really what happens afterwards. And it could be that the site that we're looking at is one of these more lowland settlement sites, less sort of defended, because there's no need to defend their families and their resources at that stage. So it's the kind of site that hasn't been investigated much in the past because it's not so obvious, because it's not so monumental. And I think that makes it far more important because it's probably telling us more about everyday activities and more sort of normal sort of trade patterns and things.
I think John's geophysics give us a real insight into the sort of local activity that's taking place as well. So we're seeing what look to be pits and activity. There might be industry. There's almost certainly going to be industry taking place here. We've got these enclosure type features, which I think we'd call them banjo enclosures, wouldn't we, Miles?
Yes, yeah, that's that banjo and antenna enclosures. Certainly there is one nice sort of distinctive ditch that we can see on here, and it looks like there is an entranceway coming off it. So a funneling entrance down and possibly sort of other enclosures like petals around a flower with a major settlement area in the middle. That looks like the kind of banjo enclosures that we've been investigating in Dorset before. So we think of that as a settlement zone, a farming zone. There's probably other similar enclosures like a linear development. And I think it's all those together that gives us this sense of quite a large settlement and industrial and agricultural area of production.
Banjo enclosures are typically mid-Iron Age.
Yes.
And so they could be high status, they could be stock enclosures, vary in composition, sometimes a ditch on the inside, sometimes a ditch on the outside. But the burials that we found when we first dug here, they're zero. Sort of bang on zero, maybe a little bit BC, maybe a little bit AD, but they're repeating Duotrigian burial traditions, but they're burying them inside a banjo enclosure. So are they revisiting this site, or is it contemporary? There's some real questions to be had.
And are there banjo enclosures that give us a sense of what we might find?
So yes, there's an excavation we did at Winterbourne Kingston, up near Bear Regis. Obviously, it's an aerial photograph. You're looking down, you've got the two ditches of the banjo enclosure coming here, and then the ditch goes off around in that direction, and then down here.
Oh, I see.
So you're looking at, that's the entrance. And then much of the interior is given over to these circles as storage pits, probably for grain or other sort of dairy produce. And then we've got things like this one round house you can just about make out the gully for here, and there's another one over there.
If it is a banjo enclosure, it's the furthest south to have been discovered. So anything we can learn about it will be important. And we should have a number of Iron Age roundhouses inside where extended families would have lived. There's nothing obvious on the geophys, but there's a hint of something round in the enclosure adjoining it. So we're putting a second trench in to investigate.
And that's the so-called green ditch.
Do you think it is?
I'm borderline, that's why I wanted to take in this outer ditch.
Yeah.
Because this outer ditch appears to join with the banjo enclosure ditch. And so they're going to look at the relationship there. Mm. If this is a green ditch, then there should be a good feature in the middle. Mm-hmm. But you've got this now. Well, I can
yes.
see it.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. That came up straight away. And there's a kind of weird blob coming out of... Is that, oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's see. Up.
This is weird. I was actually matching up with the geophysician. That's weird.
It happens all the time.
Meanwhile, in Trench 1, we've hit something that might suggest industrial activities within the banjo.
We're getting a good spread of something.
As if we've got a structure which is then collapsed over, maybe.
And this stone could be a part of the stone structure, do you think?
Yeah, look, I mean, it's certainly big enough, isn't it?
Yeah, and yeah.
It looks like it's been heated as well.
Yeah, look at this. Look, it's going on down here.
Fantastic.
Look at that.
OK, yeah. Something's trying to pop out here, isn't
it? Yeah, definitely. Oh, it's really clear. You can feel it as well. It's
dropped. Is that ashy over there?
Yeah, but everything is burnt. Everything's kind of mixed up. Overfired pottery. I think we've got the edge of a kiln or something for sure.
Fantastic. And that's right on the back edge of our trench, which was showing up in the geophysics as well.
So yes.
We could be coming down onto one of those targets we're interested in.
Yeah, and look how shallow it is. We were thinking, right, we need to go down, what, 30, then we went 40. So actually, probably go down to 60 centimetres max.
Maximum, yeah. And then we've got the post pads at the far end of the trench, which are, what, 40 to 50 centimetres down. And in the middle, where we've got nothing, we've got even deeper.
What's that? Oh, my word.
Oh, wow, look at that.
That is beautiful.
Can you see the decoration on there?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you've got the top of the... Is that the rim going across the top there as well, where your hand is?
Yeah, and kind of...
The striations on there.
Beautiful. We get that cleaned up. Yeah. And that is that Romano-British...
It's very, very late Iron Age into the very early Romano-British period.
Beautiful. And found right on top of a kiln, which is quite handy.
It's telling, isn't it? Ideal.
And we'll just kind of go back, you know...
Any large settlement is likely to have had a number of furnaces used as pottery kilns or for other industrial purposes. And in this area, there is a lot of ironstone, so we've invited Hayden Scott Pratt to construct the kind of furnace that might have been used to smelt iron.
This looks like fun. So what's happening here? Can I have a go? What's going on?
Anybody can join in. These two are our very expert mud mixers from Bournemouth University, mixing the mud with which we're going to make these. Here you go. Thank you.
That is quite something, isn't it? So what is this?
Well, it's a clay brick, isn't it? It's a bit of furnace fall.
Yeah. So these are bricks of clay that we're making from local clays that we've dug up, basically, to build a later Iron Age iron smelting furnace.
And it's got lots of what looks like hay in it. Is there a reason for that?
Yes, that's it. That's organic temper, and that will help hold the clay together as it dries, basically, like kind of rebar in concrete. So it's really strong.
Wow. And so this is going to survive high temperatures, is it? I mean,
we're going to subject the inner lining of that to temperatures well in excess of its melting point. So the majority will survive. So we've got to try and make the iron before the whole thing kind of starts to dissolve.
It's all an experiment, but, you know...
With enough bricks prepared, we're ready to start building the kiln. Sense, you
know? They seem to me to be big, to be going around that...
This is the fun part, but essentially it's going to be roughly...
Oh, is that the size of it?
That's the internal diameter, and then we will be putting...
Oh, right. Okay.
So put that one just there. Yep.
Nice. So if you'd passed through this landscape in this period, there would have been women, children, men, all kind of working in this way, stamping on the mud, creating these clay bricks and building these kilns.
Yeah, absolutely.
It'll make them a little bit thinner because we're already sitting up a little bit to get there. 20 minutes.
No, I've already brought some over.
And it starts to get musical at this point.
Oh, lovely.
And essentially, we're making a giant ceramic vessel.
Matt's expanding Trench 1 towards the banjo ditch, away from the possible kiln, where the type of pottery we've been finding has pushed our story into the later Roman period.
What date's that?
It's very late 4th, 5th century.
Wow. So that's stretching the story.
It certainly is. It's right at the end of the black burnished ware industry in Ware and Poole Harbour. Everything was going pear-shaped within the local economy, and the potters had one final attempt at commercialisation in this sort of fabric. Generally orange at a time when everything else has been black or brown. The finger-tipped rims, rope-rimmed jars, big jars, potentially for a completely different purpose than anything they've made in ceramics before.
That was nice.
So where Dan's working now, if that's the furnace where this pottery is being made, that's incredible, right?
It is. That's the first one we will have found.
The first ever?
Yeah.
The discovery has had quite an emotional effect on Rachel.
The James Gerard red type. I was the first person who identified this stuff.
Wow.
And if I've now got the first kill...
That's overwhelming.
It's more than I can cope with.
So if this is a late Roman kiln, there must have been people living and working in these fields for centuries. The question is, in what way did the settlement develop? And did they have to adapt the way that they were living? We've recruited a number of eager students to help Carenza work out how far the settlement stretched with a series of test pits.
So we're going to do 8 test pits in this field, sort of 4 of them closer to the hedge, 4 of them further away, and hopefully they'll give us an idea of whether there's similar amounts of material coming out from this part of the field as there is in the main bit, in which case it'll mean the settlement isn't tailing out, it's carrying on here and it's just the geology is a bit different. Or if we get very little here, it'll suggest that the settlement does end closer there. And then we'll maybe do the next run of test pits, the other side of the hedge, and get a bit closer. But that's the basic principle. Okay.
Stuart has started his landscape survey by trying to locate the most important of features, a water source. And he's following the hedge line between the test pits and the main excavations.
I'm now walking down the hedge line that defines the southern side of the field with our excavations in. And I've dropped down again into the valley that I've been following. And rather interestingly, as I get to this point, I can hear water tinkling. And there's water coming into the drain alongside the hedge line here, but that water will be coming from somewhere. That's not rainwater at the moment. It's not water from drains or anything like that. Somewhere higher up the slope is going to be a spring that's bringing that water down to this point, and then it's being managed into drains. Now, it's rather nice to hear that sound about where might water be on the site.
The sound of trickling water should lead Stuart to a spring further up the hillside. We're well into the afternoon, and in Trench 2, Hilda and Ivan have come down on features very quickly. but there's no sign of a ring ditch as yet.
Where's my roundhouse?
Don't know yet, but we are getting a lot of features.
Okay, what's this? Is it one ditch or two? It looks forky.
So we thought it was one ditch when we did the first trip here, but it seems to split up or widen there. With a bit of potential natural in the middle, so...
And that's cut by a later field drain, I presume?
Yes, there's a couple of field drains in this trench as well.
So the roundhouse should be there, but it's a bit higher up there, so does that mean we need a bit of manual cleaning to figure that out?
Yeah, so we left it a bit higher there because we don't want to accidentally cut it away with the machine because it could be quite
shallow.
Yeah,
it could shallow. Be really
ephemeral. So we're just giving it a good hard clean.
Great.
So Ivan's already doing a great job there.
Trench one is now enormous, and Jackie started to look for signs of a cemetery next to where the two women's graves were discovered.
Talk me through the strategy. Where have we got to so far?
Right, so our blue flags here, they're our original trench.
Okay, so this is the end of that trench where we had the two burials.
Exactly, so where Jackie's working, she's working in this our trench extension, where we had our two burials, and possibly we had that hint of a third one. Mm. So we're just really
so
trying...
So that would be just there,
just
right?
Under there, yes. Do you remember the furnace, or what we're calling a furnace? That was characterised by the orange clay, and we're getting more of that, which is brilliant. So that's...
But what's this in the corner, Harry?
We've got that there.
OK, so that's a continuation of the what we thought was a kill.
But the big news is, in our extended trench, in the bigger trench, we've got what looks like another furnace, okay?
I mean, this looks much more substantial, though.
Yeah. So this is stone-built, whereas over there we've got melted sort of clay, burnt clay and so on.
I mean, could this just be tailings of burnt clay, scrapings from the furnace? Does it...?
It could be, yeah. It may be maybe the remnants of what was going on over here. We're not quite sure yet.
Running right through the trench, the geophys shows the line of what should be the big banjo ditch.
So what we're standing on here, I think it's natural.
I'm going to disagree.
That's fine. You're allowed to.
I think that this. Sorry, guys. I'm actually thinking archaeologically for a second. I think this is a bank, Harry.
It could be the.
Like, if you imagine the ditches here.
Yeah.
This is all upcast. This is natural, but it's really natural.
And then they've got.
So this is. Guff, later guff, filling in up against the ditch. So that is true natural, where Jackie is.
Yeah.
So that is the level of our true natural. This could even be a buried topsoil with all the scrapings of the kiln and the guff of life. I mean, you've even got it here, look.
So it's this, it's coming white. Around here, yeah. The white there.
Yeah. Could it not be?
It could be.
Well, there's only one way to find out, and that's to keep digging. James has already found a lot of pottery in the ditch, which should help us to date the enclosure. Dan's trying to confirm whether Harry's kiln theory holds water, and Jackie's spotted some bone fragments which have survived despite the acidic soil.
I don't think that's... Yeah, that's a piece of animal bone, it's not human.
It doesn't look in situ. The thing is, just because it's animal bone doesn't mean to say it's nothing to do with the burials, because, of course, the burials would sometimes have had animal offerings in the graves.
That's right.
So bits of meat could go in there. So
it's quite telling. Yeah. We haven't found any other animal bone, have we?
Yeah. So it's still an important find.
Yeah.
Where Jackie's digging should be the heart of the settlement, but we're beginning to find evidence. It stretched all the way into the test pit field.
Oh, can we peel back the covers? Oh, look at that! That's proper structure, isn't it?
It is, yes. It's a man-made surface, a person-made surface of local iron-rich sandstone.
I mean, that'll be showing up in the geophysics nicely.
I'd have thought so. Nice oof. Edge along there. I don't think that joint there can be made.
This is a structure for sure. So did you get any dating material out of it?
We've had one very small piece of pottery
look.
Over in that tray over there, about as big as your finger end.
But it doesn't get much more black burnished than that. That We'll have to show this to Grace in a minute, but I'm pretty sure that's either late Iron Age or early Romano-British. And that came out of there.
Yeah, sitting in the stones amongst here, yeah.
Wow. Yeah. So that is a structure from the period we're looking for, potentially.
Excellent, isn't
so
it?
So can I see under your foot there that you're expanding this test?
We are. Corinne's ordered us.
Super duper.
To extend the trench, and she wants a soil sample taken from this layer.
Lovely.
Immediately on top of there.
Fantastic. Well, I better leave you to it. You've got, what, an hour left today?
No, so
crack on. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Later.
By tea time, we've got 8 test pits and 2 large trenches on the go. But apparently, that's not enough for Derek.
What on earth is going on? Chaps.
Hello. You better what put is this it? On, pal.
It's gone 5 o'clock and you're, what, looking like you're going to dig another trench?
Yes, we are, but...
Better put one.
This one was... In a way, so straightforward, we could probably resolve this in plan quite quickly.
Tell me, where are we on the geophys?
We're at what we think is the entrance. You know, we talked about this funneled entrance going into the main banjo enclosure. Well, the one ditch comes through here. So the idea is if we take the trench across, go over that ditch, see what the big pits are on the geophysics inside, and see if we can find the other ditch on the second side. That's all.
Okay. But to start at 5:10, though, but...
Doesn't matter. I've got my beer ready for 5:30, so...
You say it matters to me, because presumably I'm going to be the one standing here digging it out. Okay, fire up, John. Let's get going.
It's a beautiful afternoon, just right for a geography field trip to nearby Studland Beach.
Yeah, so the geology here is rich in iron, and the beaches here at Studland and the cliffs, iron ore were rode out and we call it ironstone.
So is that what's causing all that red in the cliffs?
The red coloration on the cliff, yeah. So, and the ironstone pebbles will erode out and will form part of the pebble beach that's over there. So this little piece here is a piece of ironstone. This is a really good bit. You can tell because it's nice and high density, it's really nice. Heavy, and it leaves this lovely dark brown red ochre coloration.
So, that is heavy, isn't it? Yeah. For a small pebble. So this can be smelted into iron.
Yes.
But also you said ochre. Is this the same stuff as is used in the Paleolithic?
Yeah. So ochre crayons, ironstone crayons in the Paleolithic 12,500 years ago. And then iron ore in the Iron Age 2,500 years ago.
Back on site, we're beginning to see signs of industry, the banjo ditch and the bank all within Trench 1.
I think the story is there now. We're starting to get a sense of the chronology and the narrative, and it starts out, as we suspected on the geophysics, with an early enclosure, a ditch around an area where all of the upcast was chucked inside of the enclosure to make a bank, and we've actually got that bank preserved in places, I think, which is really unusual.
That's brilliant to see, isn't
it? We can see where that bank is, and what that then suggests is that site would have been visible for hundreds, if not 1,000 years, until the modern plough came and essentially trashed it. So that's probably why we've got then burials being buried here, because they're being buried inside a structure, inside a visible enclosure. And I suspect it explains the kiln as well, because banks are great places to build kilns. You just build it into the bank, you have your opening on the front. So it could well be that kiln over there was dug into that bank, that earlier bank.
And what's happening over here?
Well, this, you know how you get an end of the day treat. So we've been looking for connections between our site and the harbour, and I think it might be emerging in this trench.
You remember we had this enclosure ditch?
Yeah.
Okay. And so James has taken out half of this ditch, and this is at the side of it here. And right on the side of it, about halfway down, it looks like some form of ceramic. But on closer inspection, we think it's briquetage.
What's briquetage?
Briquetage is used for the production of salt. So it's like a boiling pan, and it's really, really diagnostic of the late Iron Age.
Mm. Oh!
So what we think is happening here, briquetage is being made here, that those pans are being created, fired, and then they're being transported about a kilometre to the edge of the harbour, where actually that salt water is being harvested, boiled off, and from it, that salt is being produced.
So this is only the end of day one, and already it's yielding so much. You must be delighted.
I can't wait for day 2. I just want to carry on. Do we have to stop?
Matt's still going in Trench 3, but predictably, the archaeology is not as easy as Derek had thought it was going to be.
Is that looking a bit yellow inside? Everything just looks kind of off grade, isn't it?
Oh, it's impossible to see in this light,
really,
isn't it?
Really hard to see with the shadows and stuff you had last
year. Yeah. What I do is I dig your 10 metres there, and you may get better light in the morning.
Yeah.
We've had evidence of occupation from Iron Age to Late Roman, but one thing in particular appealed to our finds team.
So these have come out this afternoon, and I'll let Rachel have a look at that one. I know that's a particular favourite.
Well, this one, again, black burnished ware. It's a base sherd. And at some point during the life of the vessel, somebody has gone to the trouble of drilling these holes through the bottom to change the use of a pot. Mm. They stop it being a container. Mm. It would now leak, can't be used. They wanted it for something else. Mm. It could be for a whole heap of things, from a flower pot to potentially a clock, if you filled the pot sand, and then filtered water through the sand, that would be a measure of the time it took for that water to go through.
Into the virtual museum it goes, to sit alongside the two women who lived here 2,000 years ago. The evening sun is throwing its light over a hillside that's defined this landscape for millennia. It's a source of inspiration to Dorset folk duo Ninebarrow, who are named after one of the monuments on the ridge.
In Summer Fires is a song that it's literally written about this hillside. The traditions of Midsummer Day lighting fires in the high places around a settlement. And it being a time to look forward to the harvest and hope that it was going to bring everything that you dreamt of, and it was going to feed your family. And the idea was that you would leap over the dying embers of the flames of that fire, and the higher that you leapt, the higher your harvest would grow.
And what better way to celebrate Time Team's 30th birthday than with a Geotrigian-inspired hog roast as we consider our plans for day two. Well, the end of a really, really special day, and it just feels so appropriate that we end it with the whole of the Time Team family enjoying a pint. Cheers.
You jump high, but I jump higher. We'll dance tonight across the fire.
Join a thriving worldwide community of Time Team fans on Patreon.
Our new target is to reach 15,000 worldwide supporters on Patreon by the end of 2025. This will enable us to continue expanding the Time Team world with more digs and greater access than ever before.
The dramatic backdrop of Corfe Castle is the scene of Time Team's 30th birthday dig. Three trenches are underway as we try to find out whether two women discovered in the field were part of a rare Iron Age cemetery, what kind of community they lived in, and how it was affected by the arrival of the Romans. Yesterday we found pottery from the Iron Age right through to the end of the Roman period, and maybe even a kiln that it was fired in.
So where Dan's working now, if that's the furnace where this pottery is being made, that's incredible, right?
It is. That's the first one we will have found.
The first ever?
Yeah.
That's the worst time. The campers are up bright and early to make the most of the stunning location before getting stuck into the trenches. Beginning of day two, and what a fantastic day it was yesterday. But apparently it's going to pour tomorrow, so today we've really got to get to grips with this site. So we're back up to Matt's trench to see what's going on. Work's already underway in all three trenches. Hilda's busy in trench two, where there's a hint of a ring ditch, possibly from an Iron Age roundhouse. Hayden and Helen are preparing the furnace they built yesterday for iron smelting later in the day. And we've got our work cut out in trench one, where we're trying to get to the bottom of that banjo ditch, a possible kiln, some post holes, and potentially another burial.
So Matt,
yes, how's it going? We've come at an opportune moment, actually. We've just found, well, bone or tooth, isn't it?
Something wow. Like it's looking pretty bovine,
fantastic,
isn't it?
Yeah, and we know we've got burials over there, so it's literally just come up, so we're having a bit of a discussion about what to do.
That is amazing. And this actual trench, what is it beginning to reveal?
Well, this is over the entrance to the banjo enclosure. So we've got the two sides to the entrance coming down there and there. And we've caught the first side, which is this huge ditch there. You see, next to Sam, the white sand. Yeah. That's one side of the ditch. Then you've got, 3 metres of ditch? And then it's popping up on this side. And it looks like we've got the remnants of a bank on this side, which is where all this clay is. So Lawrence and I, we're standing inside the entrance.
Wow, so this is what we were talking about yesterday, Lawrence, isn't it?
That absolutely.
This is the entrance to our banjo.
To get remains of the bank in itself is pretty unique and pretty special. Often these are ploughed out and lost. Also, if it is the bank, we might have a buried earth surface underneath that. So we could find a bit of Iron Age ground surface, which would be incredible.
So we're hoping that this ditch joins up with the one James was excavating in Trench 1 yesterday. In it, he discovered sherds of a large pot, which Harry thinks could be briquetage, the evaporation vessel in which water is boiled during salt manufacture. It's sitting on top of something made of shale.
Thank you.
And next to a large piece of bone.
Mm-hmm. Now, what have we got? Hey, lovely. Beautiful firing shadows and colours on the side of the jar.
That is a beautiful thing. And so that gives a real way of us understanding how this was actually fired and made, doesn't it?
Yes. Lovely piece. Very shortly, I'll be able to stick this one together.
No.
Yeah, I won't glue it, but I can put it in the pieces in relationship to each other within, as soon as I've washed it, really.
That's incredible. And this is our base.
Oh, wow.
Right, you ready?
Yeah.
It's going to go.
It's going to go.
I think that's all the jar.
Mm. Yeah.
Mm. We're taking soil samples to look for what was inside the jar before James is able to carefully lift the fragile shale.
That was fantastic.
Now, do I dare? Yay. Oh, look, we've got part of a pot on the underside.
Oh, wow.
And I know we have another bit of that vessel that you found yesterday.
Mm. What, you
I recognise it. I recognise it. It's got the lines going along it. That edge is certainly roughly chipped. That one looks fairly rough too, but I think these cut marks in the surface are old. I don't think that's your trowel. Mm. So I think this was perhaps a cutting board or a chopping board that broke.
The shale probably came from Kimmeridge on the other side of the ridge, where it's been mined for centuries. We're putting another trench in over a square feature on John's geophys that looks a bit Roman.
I think you're pretty much near the edge there, aren't you? So that sort of darker band coming down on that side there.
Yeah.
And in trench two, Hilda's been searching for signs of a roundhouse in the enclosure adjoining the possible banjo.
So we were looking for a potential ring ditch.
Do we think we've got it?
I think I may have got it. Mm. Being very careful in saying that. So I'm just cleaning it back here. If it's there, it's very shallow because it doesn't seem to exist.
I mean, that's what we'd expect from a drip gully type thing though, right?
Yeah.
It's not going to be a substantial structure, but that's amazing. So that is looking like a feature now.
Yes, but we've got lots of other things going on as well.
Oh, what else is going on?
We've got a small kind of burn feature in the corner of the trench.
And is that where you're thinking of extending, yeah, having the machine bring it back?
Just extending it so that we can get all of it.
Nice, and the ditch is starting to take shape over there.
Yeah, so a nice chunky ditch there. So again, we're just getting it a bit more cleaned up now, and then we'll just whack a big slot through it.
Just a couple of fields away, there's a path up onto the ancient ridgeway above the site towards the impressive ruins of Corfe Castle.
Well, there you go, Stuart. You don't get many better views than
that. Look at that. That's definitely worth the effort of riding up here.
Agreed.
I mean, you can't imagine any period where that doesn't almost attract the same attention that we give it. Look at that.
Yeah.
And you think of monuments that are deliberately built in prehistory, like Silbury Hill. We're deliberately creating high monuments to be impressive. It's a great example to me of how geology dictates everything. And gives you that, I mean, the visual impact when you're on site of that in the middle of the gap is just so, it's almost artificial in its beauty, isn't it? In its natural beauty.
Yeah, it's a shame there's a castle plonked on top of it, really.
You've just offended every medievalist in the country,
yeah,
you know,
that's fine. It's almost certain that there were earlier features and monuments on that mound, isn't it?
I wouldn't be surprised if there was a Bronze Age barrow positioned on there, for instance, like we've got on, you know, examples on a ridge here. But I mean, whether I'd visualise something like a hill fort on top of there, I'm not absolutely certain.
It's almost like a natural gateway, isn't it? It's funneling people through from the south to Poole Harbour, from the north to the resources we know that are on the coast.
And that would increase in importance from the Iron Age through into the Roman period, when it becomes a sort of major area for imports and so on.
So given its location, our site could have played a part in Roman trade systems and been increasingly influenced by Roman culture, a possibility reflected in our finds.
So what have you got for me then, Keith?
I've been detecting Nat's trench in the spoil, and I think we've got our first period find.
It looks very much like you have. Is that okay if I take hold of it here?
Yes, please do.
Oh, yeah. So it's a copper alloy finger ring, and you can tell from the form that it dates to the 1st century AD. So exactly the same date as that burial. And then you can see here just about that there's a setting, and it seems to have blue glass in it, and that's quite a popular sort of form of decoration. So in the Roman period, it looked really nice, like a nice almost like it's gold with a bright blue setting in it. What I find really interesting about this finger ring is just how small it is. Mm. It very definitely looks like it's been made for either a child or a young woman.
And what sort of young woman would have worn this ring?
So it's not a poor person, but it's not somebody from the elite, really.
It's tempting to imagine one of the small women buried here wearing a ring like this. It came from the spoil heap of Matt's trench, where he's found some pits inside the funnel of the possible banjo enclosure.
Here's the pathway, here's the entrance coming along this way. The enclosure is in front of me there. But inside this pathway, I don't know if you can see, great big dark splodge there. A really massive dark splodge there. These are all pits, probably, something like that. Giant pits, and a bit of what could be either chalk or possibly Purbeck marble there. Another big feature here, and we get to this bit here, and here's the other side of the entrance.
Pits like these sometimes sealed the entrance of banjo enclosures when they went out of use when the Romans arrived around 43 AD. After this, the trend was for more linear enclosures and buildings, which Miles is hoping to find in Trench 4.
This is structural material. We were machining back and we come up a little bit, but there's this whacking great big stone.
I mean, that's not there naturally, is it?
No, I mean, this is faced on this, so this is actually something which I think might actually be the cornerstone of a building.
So this could be a building?
It could be. I mean, I'm thinking if it's actually there, that's where it was the machine hit, and we've got something going off in that direction, and there's certainly a lot of stonework in here, so
So you've got hopeful
building here, possible kiln there, did you say? Should
there's,
have a look.
Yeah, yeah, there's an area of burning activity here. And you can Ooh. See this is coming off onto this surface. I mean, that's all baked clay.
I mean, that, if it is, that's possibly three or four we've got on site now.
Quite a lot going on, isn't there?
Yeah, yeah.
And burning or pits, do you think?
We've got, I mean, it's a large area of burning here. You can see we've got charcoal, again, baked clay. I think we might have a large pit or ditch feature into which a lot of this sort of industrial material has been dumped.
So if we've got a wall over there, we could sort of tentatively think possibly Roman. Is it worth getting the detectorists into the trench to see if they can hit anything?
I think so, absolutely. We need to get some targets. There's certainly a lot of Roman pottery that's been coming off during the machining.
What that kind of reminds me of is, you know, you get the bases of amphora.
Yes.
There,
okay,
cool.
As well as pottery, we have our first Roman coin.
It's not a victory.
Oh, no.
It's a personification of agricultural wealth, who's a lady called Annona.
Okay.
A silver denarius, dating from 222 to 228 AD. By lunchtime, the whole site is a hive of activity, with volunteers pot washing, detectorists scanning the spoil heaps, students in the test pits, and our furnace getting its final touches. Given that we've got a lot of clay and several kiln-like features, we're beginning to wonder whether pottery making was part of industrial activity on this site.
So okay. We've extended the trench slightly, so yeah. you're in the extension. We've extended it this way as well. And we can begin
You've got
to
more
see.
Coming out,
yeah,
you?
We've got this... more coming out. So we're actually getting the full extent
is this
of the structure.
A big structure.
Now. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we actually we think we've got a bit of collapse there as well. So that's really nice. So we're beginning to see a bit more extent of this structure itself. So that's really good. That's going to progress for the rest of the day now.
Is my bank still a bank, or have you killed my theory?
No, we're working on it. You know, it's touch and go at the minute.
Yeah.
Dan's done an amazing job here. Just really. Trying to tease out what's going on.
I can see lots of material. Are we getting anything good?
Yeah, we're getting kiln furniture, possibly. We're getting some briquetage. We're also getting some just domestic pottery as well.
So could the waste material here relate to this kiln feature, or do we think that's two different phases?
Yeah, too early to say, Dan.
Okay.
Naomi's about to float the soil from the jar that James lifted out of the banjo ditch earlier.
I've got the pot from trench.
Oh, wow, look at it. It's amazing. Look at the size of these pieces.
Huge. And isn't that one beautifully coloured?
So is this an Iron Age goodie or...?
No, I think it's actually 1st century AD. Everything else in that ditch is broadly middle of the century to maybe 80 AD.
OK.
We're hoping to confirm whether the pot was used for briquetage or storage.
OK, so this is dropping through nicely. I can feel...
Still more charcoal.
Look at that, isn't it?
So cereal grains would be nice.
They would be, I mean, that's one. Oh, wow.
Look at that one.
Look at this, look.
Oh, more pot.
More pot.
Lovely. Oh. And that is, no, that's not more pottery.
No.
That's one of the deceptive stones.
Oh. There's another small piece there.
That's pottery.
That's fine.
All the work we're doing on site is being fed into the dome, where Stuart, Eve and Neil are working on the reconstructions.
I'll take them over.
It's like we're doing the chores of yesteryear.
Exactly.
You take the logs over.
Let the computer do it for us. Yeah, so I'll take the logs over and stick them in there. Yeah.
The reconstruction will eventually be populated with willing volunteers, whom Bear is capturing on his green screen.
Back over here again. I want to see these two with lightning in the back.
By the end of 3 days, we hope to be able to paint a picture of what life was like for our two Durotrigian women. Jack has identified some features near where they were buried, which he thinks might be graves. And right next door to this are some post pads from some sort of wooden building.
Meg, with everything going on in this trench, I feel like I've neglected you up here. What is going on?
This is really exciting. We actually have an early Roman structure here.
Ooh.
I know. So if you follow this really quite a nice bright orange layer. Mm. This is our interior floor surface.
So it's an actual floor surface, and these are the posts.
Yeah, it follows our nice post pads, yeah.
So have we got six of these, or just three and then...?
There's a nice three, but there's also one here. We had one in just there that we've here, taken yeah. out, and there's some potential ones in the section edge.
You say early Roman, but that feels a bit too early for up here,
I know,
right?
We thought this was post-Roman, but actually, from the pottery, we know that this is first century AD. We've got some nice inverted rims.
That really squishes the chronology of this trench, doesn't it? That's really interesting.
Yeah, ooh, it's super exciting.
Derek. Oof, oh, oh.
Derek, how are you? I haven't seen you all day.
I'm all right, there's a lot going on.
There's a lot going on. I'd like some water to go on, please.
Go on.
I'm just coming to check you're happy for me to open Trench 5. Because Trench 5 is this little cell, this area of like cellular enclosures with high mag features in the middle of them. It's only one more trench.
I'm a bit worried though, because it's halfway through day two. We've got a day and a half left and we've got so much going on in these trenches. Have we got the resource to deal with it?
We've got the resource. It's not a big trench like the ones we've got. It's okay. Only going to be a digger width.
A trial trench. Okay.
It's long, it's 30 metres, but it catches everything and it's just going to give us a little insight into this really intriguing area.
And we'll stop there?
We'll stop there, unless you want to do more.
Just the 30 metres then, Lawrence.
All right, John. This is the one.
Hello.
So you're gonna like
the pressure's on, and Hayden needs to get the furnace lit as soon as possible if he's going to get it to a high enough temperature for iron smelting.
It's horrible when people are looking at you. Oh wow! Look at that. That's brilliant. I have to have asbestos fingers.
Actually, if you want to grab that bowl there.
Yes.
Chuck a couple of them in there, that'll be fine.
Should I drop them in the
corner?
Really?
Yeah.
A team of bellowers will take it in turns to keep the fire going and the temperature rising for the next 3 hours. James is pretty convinced that the ditch is deep enough to be a banjo ditch.
So you've got the bottom?
Hi John, I have got the bottom, yeah.
And definitely banjo ditch?
I think so, yeah. Based on the geophys, it looks that way.
It is pretty clear, and as you say, if we go back that way a bit, that's what I'm seeing as the edge of the banjo, and there should be another ditch going out that way. It would be nice to see the junction with the ditch that comes under the spoil heap and joins with the banjo. You're going to put another section there?
We will, yeah. We'll try and capture that relationship just over here if we can.
Okay.
Excellent.
I'll leave you to it.
Brilliant.
So we're starting to define the shape of the ditch around the enclosure. And little details are emerging to help us work out what went on inside it.
Ah! Hello, I'm glad you came back. So, you know I said I'd be really happy if I found some carbonised grain? Well, next soil sample that went in, which actually came from the area around where the original skeletons were found. It's in that area and there's a kiln nearby. But I've got grain. And I'm really, really, really happy. Very, very well preserved.
Clues like this from archaeology are really important to understanding how the Duotriges lived, because the only documentary evidence was written by the Romans.
What was distinctive about them?
They've certainly got a distinctive type of burial. We don't get many burials for the rest of Iron Age Britain, but the Duotriges bury their dead in crouch positions. So the legs are drawn up towards the chin in like a fetal position, often in groups of about 20 or 30 within a cemetery. Their settlements, you get little polygonal style ditches around individual roundhouses, so a very scattered population. And their pottery types are also very distinct in that we get the black burnished ware style. So archaeologically speaking, they're very easy to identify, but of course we don't know anything about what they thought about themselves or, you know, anything about their religion or society.
But we do actually know something about them, because we have here our two burials. And they were small, weren't they? I mean, was that typical? I mean,
stature-wise, we tend to be seeing people who are, compared to modern-day humans, actually quite small. They're sort of, we're talking about sort of the 5 foot tall area, so quite small. I think a lot of it is due, firstly, to their diet. They're eating a heck of a lot of meat. And there's no real vegetables in their diet as well. We also know that they're living in very sort of smoky environments. So as far as their health goes, compared to a modern population, they are not very well. the individuals that we get recovered from burials aren't living to a great age. So most are dying in their 20s. We get
dying
some
in their 20s?
I think if you're getting to your mid-30s as a Druidrigian, you're doing extremely well.
Wow, wow. And so they're diminutive, they've got these meat ducks. Are they having any fun? I mean, it doesn't sound...
Well, I mean, I guess as farming communities, herding communities, there's probably not a lot of time for fun. We don't find a lot in the way of portable artwork. We don't find a lot in the way of any kind of things, which I guess you could say today is to do with recreation. So life is probably quite short and quite hard.
This description of Iron Age life matches what we're finding in the trenches, where there are indications of small industries, such as meat and pottery production.
Yeah, so I'm not sure if this is two separate features or one large rectangular.
We're not seeing the roundhouses where they lived, but we might have discovered a cemetery where they were buried. If the features Jackie and Harry are working on are graves.
Yeah, it's quite a lot of bits of...
Fragments.
Fragments of redeposited animal bone in here, yeah. It could be that it's gone in as a joint rather than disarticulated bits of bone, if you see what I mean. So I'm going to just carefully go around that. So we've got bits of upper limb, probably of, we think, pig. So we've got bits of radius and bits of ulna, and that looks like a bit of the scapular shoulder joint. So, but it's well preserved, so much for this being a very acid soil.
The soil in these parts is generally acidic sandy soil and terrible for bone survival. So Naomi's been testing the pH levels of the soil samples to look for an explanation.
Have a little look. So as you can see, somewhere between a 6 and a 7, which is conducive to preserving bone and carbonized grain.
A working theory is that all this rich, dark earth has neutralized the acidic soil and preserved the bones. And maybe other grave cuts have not survived because they were cut into more acidic soils lower down. But although we're still not certain that there was a cemetery here during the Iron Age, we're getting more of an idea about the extent of the settlement.
The test pits over on the far side there, furthest away from what I think is the epicentre where all the big trenches are, and there's all that geophysics. Trenches further away, producing virtually nothing. Going down to natural, about 30, 40 centimetres. Virtually no pottery at all, I don't think. The trenches this side, you can see one or two are still carrying on. They're going a little bit deeper, and they're producing two or three sherds of sort of sandy ware pottery that might be Iron Age, might be Roman, could be medieval.
Yeah.
There's a sense there's slightly more going on this side, but overall the feeling is very much that the intensive activity you've got on the other side is petering out in this field and has petered out by the time you're on the far side.
So that drop-off we're noticing in the geophysics could well be a real drop-off in activity.
Absolutely, yes.
Fantastic. Yeah. Now, I can't help but notice that this test pit looks a bit different.
Yes. So we extended it to here, at which point it started to look a little bit like a grave.
Yeah, I can see that.
So we then put that little notch out to see if it carried on, and we can see it doesn't. So we've now extended this way to see what's happening that end. And it seems to be there's a bit more of it here. So it's getting more and more confusing the more of it we dig.
So while some of the team work out what's happening in Test Pit 1, Carenza's moving the workforce into the excavation field to refine the extent of the settlement. And Stuart's been wandering the landscape in search of the water source he heard underground yesterday.
So this is the small valley that raises where the spring head is.
Oh yeah, I think it's got bog grasses growing in it now as well, hasn't it, to give it away.
And you can see further down where the wet area is, where the yellow flowers are. That's the small stream that flows in the winter.
Well, that'd be the one on the other side that I could hear actually running, the water running on the other side of the road.
It still flows now, but not above ground.
Right.
And you just dig a few inches in and it's flowing quite freely.
Crikey. I mean, what strikes me as I come here is the position of this spring head, in that it's not only water going that way. This actually is an access route up onto the ridge, isn't it?
It's
one of the only ones, isn't
overlooking
it?
The gap.
That's amazing, isn't it? That if you want to go up on the ridge, you're going to have to come up through here as well?
As the Cromwellian troops did when they overpowered the castle.
Oh, right, right.
Both the access to the ridge and the water must have been important for centuries. Back on site, Hayden's happy that our furnace has reached a high enough temperature to add the ironstone.
You do it first, and then I'll have a go. So I'm gonna you can take over the bellows.
Yeah. Three handfuls, so I'm going to sprinkle that in here, and I'm going to try and put that towards the back of the furnace where we're putting air in. It'll be hotter over here. Okay, so that's one, two, three. And then... grab some charcoal as well. So the idea is that the reducing atmosphere in the chimney up here will reduce it, and then down here it fuses. So mixing it in sort of layers as it goes down. Do you want me to take over?
Yes, please.
Okay, no worries.
There you go. Whew, that is exhausting.
I know, you'll be able to do CPR for hours after this.
Yes. Oh, see, your rhythm is much better. You're much more, you know, obviously more than 10 minutes experience really helps.
It does. And now grab the iron ore, yep. And do about sort of, do three or four kind of fistfuls, probably the rest of that bucket to be here, and just sprinkle that over the top there. Lovely. And this will be us for the next couple hours, hopefully.
Right. Almost till it gets dark.
Yeah, well, that would be pretty spectacular.
Yeah, yeah.
And right on cue, Chris has found evidence of some kind of metal working in Trench 5.
Actually, it's a good job you've just come over. Pulled out a couple of bits of slag from the top of this ditch.
What have we got?
You've got some, well, this is metallurgical slag without question. The density alone tells you that. Can't tell without looking at it in a bit more detail if it's smithing or smelting, but either way it means we've got metallurgical production on site, metallurgical activity, be that forging, be that smithing, or be that making metal from ore, which is fantastic. Just need a little bit more of it, Chris, if that's all right.
Yeah, no worries.
So where are you, Chris? We've got this, is the ditch that you're digging there?
So yeah,
is
we're standing in that ditch there.
Okay,
yeah.
Brilliant. And is the rest of the trench showing us what we were expecting to see?
More or less, we've got the ditches where we're expecting to see them, but we have got a few added extras, as you'd expect.
Well, what sort of things?
So we've got down there, we've got some clay footings.
Okay, just where they're digging at the moment?
Yes,
okay.
Yeah.
Let's have a look. I mean, we've got bits of this clay in some of the other trenches, haven't we? Early on, we were thinking kiln, 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 but that doesn't look particularly baked, does it? Can I step in, Chris?
Okay, of course.
Is it soft or?
Yes, it's a real difference. So up in Trench 1, we've obviously got that very highly fired, very cooked clay structure, which we're calling a kiln, and I think it almost certainly is a kiln. But this isn't cooked, this is still soft. You could pot with this if you wanted to, so it's very different.
And it's just like the lump we've got in Matt's trench in Trench 3, isn't it?
Yeah, so I wonder if it's being used as a foundation material or some sort of footing or a pad to build something else on.
Have you picked up all the ditches yet, do you think?
We think so. It's a little bit murky in the trench at the moment, but we think we're in the right places on
it. Okay, yeah. And is this sort of in the middle of one?
So I would be standing in a ditch here.
Okay, with a return behind Derek.
Yes,
okay.
Yeah.
So it's kind of in the middle of, if we are looking at workshops, it's kind of in the middle of this node of activity. I think we just need to clean it up and understand it a bit more, don't we?
I think so, yeah.
But great trench, hey Derek?
I am quite excited about this one.
Well done, Chris.
It's possible that there may have been some Roman workshops in this area of the field, if the dates of the finds are to be believed.
Look. Oh, it's another coin. Lovely. Not quite as nice as that denarius you found earlier, though, is it?
I can see a head on it. I'm thinking possibly a radiate crown there, making it as a 3rd century, 260s, 270s. But it's not easy to identify.
In Trench 4, there are two more of these baked clay deposits, which Miles thinks could be related to kilns.
That's got an edge to it, so I think that might it has to be a kiln. That really hasn't, so either that's baked clay in a feature, or it's the remains of perhaps a kiln or a furnace or something that's been dismantled, or it's just general burning activity.
The wall line that Miles picked up in the trench earlier is proving harder to pin down than he hoped.
This, We thought it was a wall. It's not. It's got, you see, you've got pottery here. We've got pot this, you've got a handle, and it's
oh,
a base.
It's a really nice
so it's
bit.
Either a lamp holder or it's some kind of fish dish. But that's late Roman. That's late Roman. And it's pottery in amongst this rubble spread. And there's
is that a large
jewel.
Rim there.
Oh, is that that's actually, it is. Sorry, that is a rim. So you've got all this pottery. So I think this is a rubble dump. And it might be it's a robbed out foundation line for a wall. So
okay,
the wall
yeah.
was here, but they've taken the stuff out and the pottery and whatever bits have gone back in here. I just can't see the edges to it.
Sounds about right for this.
Hugely frustrating.
Yep.
By digging small sections into the features, Mars hopes to identify them quickly, leaving time to investigate some of the other features on John's geophys.
John, do you want to fancy your practicing moving a wheelbarrow?
I'm quite happy to watch you.
Look, you get hold of those handles at either end, mate. It's great. Go on, give it a go. Getting stiff all day, you see, not doing anything. Watch that hole behind you.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. And where do you want
don't
it in here?
No, don't tip it in there, pet.
You sure? Just,
yeah, look, run up there with it. Get a run up it. A run up at it.
We're having to dig through vast amounts of this industrial-looking dark earth in Trench 1. And as we do so, more and more Roman or post-Roman post pads are emerging. But we're not sure what kind of building that they came from.
They're very high. If those are post pads, which they look like, then they're, and they're high in stratigraphy, which they obviously are, then the buildings are really high above everything, aren't they?
Although that pottery, that's sitting on, it's, on that surface,
isn't it?
Yeah.
It could well be floor.
It might have been a suspended floor and then it's fallen through.
Yeah, and probably was a suspended floor.
Yeah.
The question is, were the people that trod on the floor aware of the two women buried nearby? Or were they long forgotten? Part of an earlier settlement replaced by a later industrial landscape.
There's stuff in the way, okay? Right, so I'm going to give us a
when
little...
When can I stop doing this?
You can stop now if you like. Oh.
At last, we're ready to see if the experimental furnace has actually produced iron.
Okay, nothing. Because we've stopped blowing air into the furnace, we're actually going to open it up and try and get the bloom out because it's cooling down, okay? So we're going to open the whole thing up.
So the slag is too solid to flow.
Yep.
And so we've got to whack out the whole thing. My goodness.
Right. Can you feel the heat radiating
yes,
off that?
Yes, absolutely.
So don't get too close. I'm going to try and get that out of there. So that's all the charcoal that we've made.
Oh my goodness.
Nice.
Okay. Yes, we need fire screens at this
stand
point.
Stand back a little bit.
Do you need more water?
Please, if I chuck you that, catch. Oh my God. So there's this huge kind of mound in there that basically is slag and hopefully metal, but it's pretty big, which is good and bad because big might mean we can't get it out of the furnace to dismantle the furnace to get it out. We might have to get this out later.
While Hayden considers how to extract the bloom from the furnace, Derek and Lawrence are rethinking the banjo ditch theory.
Obviously we've got these Iron Age enclosures as we've interpreted, with our main one being here. Questions as to whether it's a banjo enclosure or not, but we're getting answers on that
it's
already.
Not. It's not?
No, it's that. I'm just gonna nail my flags to the mast here and say that is not a banjo enclosure. Things we'd be looking for are a ditch on the outside, we'd want a nice this antenna here, we'd want it to return clearly down there, and it's just not showing up in the archaeology. First and foremost, the ditch is clearly on the inside. We can see that in the trenches. We can see it in this section and we can see it in this section up here. And it doesn't return in the way we'd expect it to if it was a traditional
banjo.
So
that was question one and we've answered it pretty emphatically then.
Yeah, I'd probably agree with Derek on that, to be honest.
So one lingering question, an important one. Can we actually answer the question of who these two people are, these two women buried?
That's kind of the elephant in the room, because the things that brought us here were those two burials and we haven't found any more, and I was convinced we would find more. And that thing that brought us here originally, that Roman structure, we've yet to find that clear Roman structure, and I'm hoping that perhaps we can tick both of those boxes tomorrow.
We've still got a lot of questions to answer tomorrow, and there's a storm predicted which has threatened to cut short our time here. So as evening falls, Hayden's got the furnace back up and running to try to extract what he hopes is a bloom of iron.
Is that it there? That big bit on the right here?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah? Try and cut that
there,
off.
There. Okay, I've got something.
Take that.
Yep. Here we go.
Okay, oh, there it is, there it is.
Right, get that, roll that out.
Stand back.
Okay. See it?
Yep.
Oh, it's a big one, are you doing?
Oh, bloody hell.
There it is. God damn, right. Oh, okay.
Tell me when.
Hit it. Oh, that's it, go on. Okay, right.
Keep going. Happy?
Yep, keep going. Oh, there's iron in there. It's squidgy. And twist it. Okay.
There you are.
One more big hit.
Go on.
Nice. Okay. This one I'm holding. Got it.
I think that's our show.
That's iron.
Better?
Archaeological evidence suggests that the fate of this furnace was not uncommon. It took 2 days and a sizeable team to produce a lot of burnt rubble and a very small piece of iron. It's a window onto the challenges facing Iron Age blacksmiths 2,000 years ago. And I wonder whether they too might have wound down after a tough day with some music around a fire.
If you'd like to see more episodes like this, you can make it happen.
Our new target is to reach 15,000 worldwide supporters on Patreon by the end of 2025. This will enable us to continue expanding the Time Team world. Enjoy front row seats for the greatest show on Earth and under it.
We've got 1 day left of our Dorset dig in the shadow of Corfe Castle, where we're investigating how two Iron Age burials fit into the Romano-British landscape around them. We've got 5 huge trenches underway, all with complicated archaeology.
Can't see the edges to it.
This sounds about right for this.
Hugely frustrating.
We found post holes from some sort of Roman building close to the graves, and masses of pottery, including a huge first century boiling jar.
Hey, lovely. Beautiful firing shadows and colours.
A couple of bits of slag from the
and
top
there's
of this
evidence
ditch.
Of metalworking on site, as well as the remnants of furnaces. And I don't mean the one that Helen and Hayden made. We're up with the larks this morning because dark, ominous clouds are building and there's a real danger that the storm will cut short our investigations. So we haven't got long. We've got to answer some of those questions, the most pressing of which, I think, is, Derek, Rachel, is this a kiln? I mean, what is this structure?
It's a really good question.
One of the things it could be is the base of a crop processing facility. We're not quite sure what the superstructure would look like, but this would be the underneath, the sort of fired clay platform.
I think we're still in the realms of kiln, because I show you this here. What I think we've got here, all of this clay is not the base of something, but the sides of something that's fallen into a cavity. Something. And if I lift this one up, you can see how it's collapsed in, and there's nice fired lining just down there. I think we need to dig into this. We need to be a bit brutal with it today. Dig out this soft clay in the middle and see what the actual shape of the base is, and then we'll know what type of feature it is.
Whatever this is, it's just one tiny part of a huge trench.
And this trench will reveal all. It's the answer to everything.
Is that you're going to answer all of my questions?
Well, we've got a bank here. We've got a ditch.
Yeah.
We've got a bank. This bank is coming down, then we've got the soil forming on top of it. So actually, where we are now is sort of the junction of all these different elements coming together.
That's great. And what's Meg doing?
What is Meg doing? I don't know if you remember from the geophysics.
Yeah.
We had this our sort of arm coming in this way. We also then had a big ditch heading off that way. So we're trying to find sort of the relationship between the two, sort of the interface again, what's going on there. What's complicating it is that we've got loads of really nice pop in stones and so on. So we're trying to just tease out multiple different things here.
I'm nervous that in terms of bottoming this trench,
We've only bottomed a little bit more than we did in our original trench.
Yeah.
So we were talking at the end of the day yesterday about how, oh, we think we've got two isolated burials, probably no more. But really, we've only opened a few more square metres to the level we'd expect to find the burials. Is there anything we can do?
Yep, that's what I'm doing here. I'm going to work down to the natural as well, just so we can get a character of it. And where Jackie and John are working, remember in our sort of first century Roman structure, what we're going to do, we're actually going to take that out. You can see the white soil, the white sand, that's our natural. We know our graves are cut into that. So we're actually going to take it down below where Jackie is, once it's been recorded, take it down, probably with a digger,
yeah,
and just actually see if there's any more graves there.
The team are keen to get as much done as possible in case the forecast rains actually stop play. So in Trench 4, Miles is trying to get below the Roman features to see if the Iron Age settlement stretched down the hill.
So this was what we were looking at the end of yesterday, this orange stuff, yeah, which we're finding everywhere. But
absolutely, I think this is some kind of late Roman, whether pottery kilns or whatever, but that's late Roman baked clay surfaces. So that's what we saw when we first started machining. But it's this stuff down here. So if you can see this linear coming through, you can see the baked clay and charcoal within that. So that's giving us a really high reading on the magnetometer.
Naomi will get her mitts on that, I suspect.
But you can also see as we come down along here, we've got some really nice features. There's this big sort of feature here. We've got one there. There's a really beautiful one here. I mean, these could be our sort of late Iron Age storage pits.
We haven't got much time left, Miles. Are you confident we're going to get to the bottom of this? Literally.
We're going to have to, yeah. We're going to have to start working. Once we finish machining this, we'll go down through those features fairly speedily.
Back in Trench 1, Naomi's taking soil samples from the furnace, which Derek and the team are now confident that they can see in the ground.
So in front of me here, this is the raking pit where they would have built the fire. They would have pushed that through into the middle section, which is the firebox. And then beyond that, this is the firing chamber where the pots would have been stacked and fired.
But Rachel's not convinced.
I'd so love it to be a kiln, but to be honest, all of these pyrotechnical structures have those three elements. They have the fireplace, the flue, and then the stoking pit where the fire is built. So I'm afraid the jury is still out until we get waste of pottery.
This site is littered with mysterious clay deposits, and Mike's been taking a closer look at the one that Lawrence thought might have been inside a workshop.
Yeah, it's a slab, compacted clay. I don't know if it's fired. Has it been heated?
It's been heated a bit, hasn't it? But not to any substantial
degree. It's not been baked, no.
And what about, so what's coming up underneath it? Are we getting some dating?
We are, and you've arrived just at the right moment. Just underneath it here, in this very, very dark coloured soil, is this absolutely beautiful thing here.
What's that? Oh, is that shale?
I think it is shale. See the dark fabric there?
Yeah. Oh, yes, just here.
Yeah. And if you look on the side there, it's got a little impression in the middle.
Yeah.
And if you were to push your finger through there, the soil would come out. And you'd have a perfect little hole in there. It's been cut. Turn on a lathe.
It's got. Yeah, you can see that. So do you think something like a spindle
wheel? I think it's a spindle wheel. Yeah. And they hang upside down like that.
Nice weighty.
Yeah.
It's surprisingly weighty. And that is beautiful, and you can imagine it being quite a nice byproduct of the larger sort of bracelet making.
Yeah, it's an industry. They're very economical with their materials. Having dug the stuff out of the ground, you don't want to throw away something you could use.
So it's an indication that there might have been some sort of industrial activity, possibly workshops, outside the main banjo-like enclosure, which Harry is now pretty certain was dug centuries earlier.
What we've got, we know we've got this ditch behind us, okay?
Yeah.
When that's been dug out, we've got that soil, that sandy soil, has been dug out and thrown up, forming a bank. We can actually see that now. That's actually sitting on top of the contemporary ground surface when this ditch has been dug.
Oh, so you've got an Iron Age ground surface under the bank.
Exactly. And look at the colour of it. This soil is really quite light. It's grey.
It's not the black earth, is it?
It's not the black earth. So all this black earth we now know is being formed later on.
Later than this ditch.
Yeah, and it's associated not with the cutting of the ditch, not with the maintenance of this ditch, but actually with much later practices.
Now, we've got a lot of first century pottery out of this ditch. Are we saying that actually this ditch is probably earlier than that, then?
Yes.
If the ditch was dug in the Middle Iron Age, this would support the theory that this was a banjo enclosure. But to prove it, the ditches in Matt's trench would need to form a clear funnel-like entrance.
Okay, so at the end of yesterday, I was hacking away at this huge Iron Age ditch, and the last stroke, I got that sand there, and I thought, brilliant, that's the bottom of it. But then it struck me that this ditch has been cut through this really loose sand. And so the sides of it have probably fallen in and collapsed. Now this ditch is a, on the geophysics, it appears to be a part of the same ditch that goes around into trench one. James has dug a section through it over there and it's cut through clay. So his ditch is gonna be lovely. It's gonna be stable. It could well be that we're both in the same ditch, but mine is now a completely different shape to his, and there's only one way to find out, and that's just to carry on digging.
So, we're no nearer a resolution in Matt's trench, and in trench two, Hilda's investigating another enclosure ditch, which looks completely different to everything else on site.
There could be a wall, perhaps, cutting through the ditch, but we don't really know.
It's not just collapse in the ditch.
So I thought it was at first, but it seems to be a very neat line at the moment, for my liking, so I'm just trying to trace it back.
It's still Iron Age, though, you think? You're not sure yet?
I'm not sure yet. I think it's later than that.
Yeah? Maybe it'll show more clearly when it's rained a bit.
Good thing I like digging in the rain.
Yeah, I like watching in the rain.
And as the rain gets heavier, Helen's wisely taking shelter.
I've come into the dome to have a look at this Roman finger ring. I've started off with the lens to get a really detailed look, but I normally work off my short-sighted eye, which is a really handy thing for a fine specialist to have.
She's giving the ring a gentle clean to confirm what it is before handing it over to conservators.
You can see that it picks up the dirt and that we can see much more clearly when it's damp. And you can see there, I hope, that it is not engraved. Certainly it's got cracks in it, but it's not engraved. And if we take this down to the sides on the better preserved shoulder, then I think we can see already that there's no decoration coming up there, but I will carry on until it's not quite so. Cotton bud is not quite so filthy. And it is a beautiful blue colour, which is a classic Roman colour combination. Blue glass in a bronze ring. And I think that is as far as I ought to take it now. It's pretty clean and I don't want to go too far. I'd like to hand over to somebody who really knows what they're doing. So I'll leave it there.
This ring is an indication of the gradual Romanization that this settlement must have undergone in the first century. Outside, the rain's getting heavier, and although we're doing everything we can to protect the archaeology, it's becoming increasingly dangerous to continue.
Don't worry, stop now.
It appears to be raining, Derek.
John, do we want to get people off site or is this all right? It's a thunderstorm I'm more worried about.
The problem is, what we're going to start doing is actually damaging the archaeological features and deposits, which we've been so careful with up to now.
Should we have an early lunch, maybe?
I think we'll have a strategic break and hopefully this weather will pass.
Okay. Let's have a strategic break, I think.
The enforced break gives us time to take stock.
And now, this is the question. Is it a banjo or not a banjo?
I mean, the problem is we talk about banjos as if everyone conforms to a consistent plan. There's some kind of construction catalogue that everyone follows. Mm. And there aren't. It's a bounded space with a funnelled entrance. And I think that is what we have got there. We've got that space. There is some kind of funnelling going on down there. I'd like to get a bit more dating evidence out of that ditch, but I'm still happy seeing that as a banjo-esque enclosure.
But I'm sounding quite tenable, isn't it?
I guess I just get a bit hung up on calling it a banjo when it doesn't look at all like a banjo.
It does look like a banjo.
It looks like a sort of funny little heart shape. I'd really like that other ditch. I need Matt to go back out in the rain. And...
How about if we call it an antenna enclosure rather than a banjo?
I'd like that, yeah.
After a couple of hours, the rain eases, but we've lost a lot of time and more storms are forecast.
I've got a lovely collapsed section here. I got that all lovely and straight just before the rain started, and now it's an undercut mess. So hopefully Phil Harding won't be tuning into this one.
Jack is cleaning and recording the post pads in Trench 1 before we can get below them into the Iron Age layers to see if there are any more burials.
Yeah, that's fine.
Matt's still trying to find the bottom of the ditch to work out if he's got an entranceway to the much-discussed banjo antenna enclosure.
So if there's any of this dark grey fill left, like we've got round here, I'm not happy. That's all got to be gone. It's all got to be clean.
And it's a similar story in the features in the middle of the funnel entrance.
Ah, you see, he had a false bottom too, you see.
Yeah, nothing of note. The only things I've had in here are some cow teeth.
A bit of cow teeth, yeah. I've had a few of them looking around. But no pottery.
No pottery whatsoever.
Yeah. So we're inside the, what we thought was the kind of entrance to the banjo enclosure, but maybe we're not. And I'll tell you why maybe we're not. Because if we go over to where Sarah is here... So, as you can see, we thought we had the other side of the enclosure coming this way, so we marked out a great big long section for Sarah to excavate there. Just digging back, and what's that, Sarah, about 40 centimetres, max 50 centimetres?
Not much of anything.
Not much of anything at all, yeah. So it's if you think about how big my ditch was over there, I mean, I would say coming up to 2 metres, this is a tiny little thing.
As Matt wrestles with the banjo theory, Stuart Eves trying to interpret the archaeology to recreate the Iron Age landscape our two women would have inhabited.
If I zoom out again, what I've basically done is I've traced over where those enclosures are and just started putting some little marks on the ground where we might be.
Mm-hmm.
And I've also started putting together a little village. Just there's a lot of people moving about, there's a lot of industry going on.
So that this is almost now, to me, looking like a more familiar landscape with a road up to a farm, and then these are like paddocks, aren't they?
Yeah, they feel like paddocks, don't they? I mean, yeah. I think I haven't put it in yet, but these would definitely have been ditches, and especially these ones. In Matt's trench, we found which side the bank's on, so this would have been a ditch with a bank on the inside.
And the bank could have had a hedge on it?
Could have had a hedge, yep. or alternatively, the ditch could have had some, you know, nettles and brambles mm-hmm, in it. Because mm-hmm. I think they're usually used basically for cattle. Mm-hmm. And I know that Stuart had an explore with Lawrence earlier, and he thinks that might be a kind of pathway or a droveway leading into the enclosure area. So you'd come along here, and then actually he also found, presumably from the topographic survey, that there was also a stream. So we've put the little stream in.
Because that has actually been worrying us about the water sources.
Where the water
and things,
comes
yes,
from, yeah.
Yes.
So he's indicated a little stream there. So mm-hmm. we've just, again, this is very early days, and this is what's so fun about doing this, you know, on site, so that we can start building these models together.
And what about the weather? Because this is actually looking rather similar now to our weather here.
It does.
But I was wondering if you could make it look like this morning. Why don't you make it tip down with rain?
I can give it a go. Let's put some clouds in as well, just to start everything feeling a little bit.
Oh, look at that. We hoped that the furnace would show up.
There we go.
Like
so the furnace is showing up nicely. And actually, what you really want to do now is head into that little house and have a bit of a rest. So we could just walk past our furnace and.
Oh, it's so gloomy.
It's so gloomy, yes. and already you can see with the puddles appearing, and it's all muddy, and you know. But at least this looks quite nice inside.
But at least yes. And what's in there? There's a fire.
Yeah, there's a fire. Well, actually, it looks like the roof's leaking, but...
Oh, that's true, quite badly. Oh, but supper's
there
cooking.
There we go, supper's cooking. Yeah, and We've got a nice bed there as well, if you want to have marvellous. It curl up and be...
At the rain outside.
Look at the rain outside and hope that the roof doesn't leak too much.
Outside in Trench 4, Miles is trying to see what he can add to that Iron Age landscape.
I'm pleased to see you're not in a swimming pool.
Yeah, it's a close one thing.
But I think we're down to 3 hours now instead of 3 days. What do you think?
We've been delayed a lot by the rain. Unfortunately, the rain has smeared a lot of what we were excavating here, but we've certainly got a series of pits coming up in here. My sort of working theory is that what we've got here is our sort of Iron Age features, the things that drew us to the site in the first place. But the reason we didn't see them in this trench, we stopped when we got at the late Roman levels. But this prehistoric stuff is very much buried underneath. So the question is where all that soil is coming
from. That's fascinating, because in theory then, these features could be contemporaneous with our banjo-adjacent enclosure up there.
Yeah.
And yet between then and the late Roman stuff, we've got...
a lot of soil build-up. And it's not just hill wash, there's a lot of ash in there as well. So I think it's...
So this is life, this is people doing stuff.
That is a lot of activity, and it's really, as I say, it's just covering everything.
The big question then is dating down here.
Yeah, we haven't had any finds coming out as yet, but we're hopeful. I mean, there's some really nice pit features in there. We just need to get them cleaned out.
3 hours, Miles. Good luck.
Thank you, Derek.
In Trench 1, Naomi's taking yet another sample as she tries to solve the debate about what the kiln-like structure was used for.
So earlier this morning, I processed a sample that was taken from that end and from this end. And it's interesting because I had a few carbonised grains.
Oh.
Which is great, but only a few, which is not enough, okay? So I've come up here to take a sample that's much further down and therefore potentially more sealed, less likely to be mixed up.
Yeah.
And then once I process it, hopefully we'll get something nice and juicy from it, which can really definitively tell us what this is.
That would be amazing.
At the other end of the trench, next to where the burials were, we're digging below the Roman post holes to see if there are any more graves or any other features dating to the Iron Age.
More animal tooth. I think that might be cattle or horse animal tooth.
And straight away, we've hit some packing stones.
He's just touched these stones, but there's ones in situ here, and it's exactly what we've had before.
The trouble is, this slows everything down, as each new feature has to be cleaned and recorded. The good news is, Carenza's test pits were pretty much completed before the rain, and they've demonstrated the extent of the settlement.
So we've got kind of three patterns of data coming out of the test pit, really. So 16 here at the bottom end of the site, where we've got, and you can see that 30 centimetres, that's your natural, that's kind of all done. And pretty much all of the test pits around here are variations on that theme. Even test pit one, where we thought we had a feature. And as you can see here, when we'd got this far, it looked like we had the Tom talk of a grave at one point. But actually, you can see it's just a series of geological bedding planes. It's just what the natural is doing. So then we had the second category of pits, which are kind of giving us where the settlement's still just fading out, if you like. Yeah, 11 over here. And 17 both did that. We just finished 17 literally a few minutes ago, and you can see it started off looking quite dark, so it's not as light as the others, but actually we got down here again. We've got this sort of sense of there, we've got the bottom. You can see it so clearly, and it's fantastic. Mm-hmm. And there's that orangey deposit again, and it's at about 50 centimetres.
Yeah, so they're getting deeper as we get closer to where we've put the trenches.
And slightly more fines as well. And then we get the third category of test pits, which are completely different to those. So they're like 9 here, where really deep test pit. So that's about 67 centimetres, 60, 70 centimetres, burning just like we're getting in the main trenches. Some of these little kind of possible stake hole features.
Fantastic.
So you can see we've got a tray of fines from the upper context. We've got another one from the next context. And then really, once we're getting deep down, we've got really big chunks of fines, pottery in there. So what we've got really from all of these is that sense that the the geophysics is giving us a good, reliable indicator of how far the actual site goes.
So, we're right in the middle of the settlement in Trench 1, where we keep finding more post holes.
So this circle here, Harry, can you see it?
Yeah, I've got that, John.
That's got to be a post hole.
It is a post hole, I think, yeah, isn't it? Yeah.
Okay, so looking at the data which we surveyed earlier, remember we had that ring of stones, which you said was post packing?
Yeah.
This is exactly the same place, we're just deeper down.
Fantastic. So actually, my eye of faith would be saying there looks to be something smaller in the middle. Basically, that is where the wood has actually, post has actually been in. And the stuff at the top is the packing around the upper levels
of it. Just to stop it waggling.
Just to stop it wiggling about.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Even though we haven't found any Iron Age dwellings within the settlement, the finds suggest that there must have been people living here for centuries.
So, Grace, if I can start with you, what is this Iron Age assemblage, do you think? What are we looking at?
This is all typical late Iron Age Poole Harbour wares, sort of Duratrian style vessels. They're all made locally. They're domestic vessels. We have this really nice part. This is probably, these are probably our earliest, perhaps around 20 BC to 20 AD. You can touch that and you can feel how they've sort of pinched up this lug on that vessel there.
Oh, yes, it fits quite.
You can sort of feel where they have a finger.
Has been in the, yes, that's amazing. Wow.
And then we have these nice countersunk handled jars. Mm-hmm. These types of vessels are flat rim jars.
Is this all one pot?
Yes, this is all found in a ditch section in Trench 1. Interesting because you can see all this variation in the colour. So this is just the way it's been fired. They're fired in a bonfire. They would have had other vessels packed around them.
Yeah, so it's not deliberate.
No.
Just lucky.
Yeah, just lucky.
So this is all dating to the Iron Age, but we've still got our Iron Age burials. So are they going into a domestic site that's then immediately carrying on in use? I mean, Philippa, is there a gap between the late Iron Age and the early Roman?
Well, there possibly could be a gap. The coins are all solidly 2nd or 3rd century in date. And we've got some objects that could be 1st century, but they're probably 2nd century. However, we really have to think about who these people are who are using these Roman objects. They're probably not Roman incomers. They're the local people who are just making use of Roman material culture.
So how Roman do they look, Rachel?
We have a major break in ceramic styles in the Wareham Poole Harbour industry round about AD 120. And we have some examples of that. We have vessels, bowls, dishes with flat rims. Sometimes they have a groove in. We have jars with slightly more sticky out rims. We are also beginning to see some imported wares. So we have some central Gaulish Samian, a nice decorated bowl, although not a lot of it survives, and a piece of black colour-coated ware beaker, probably made in the same area around Clermont-Ferrand in France. We're moving later now. Here we have pottery made locally again, but very, very typical of the second half of the 3rd century onwards, so from about 250 to 400 AD. These are the classic types of black burnished ware that move all over the country and were traded very, very widely.
What I find really interesting is that there's so much late Roman pottery, but we're not seeing any late Roman coins at all. You'd expect on any Roman rural settlement in that period to at least get a few radiates, a few 4th century nummy, but there just aren't any coming up from this site.
So we've got domestic life, but they don't seem to be doing anything that needs coins, you know, like trade or whatever.
Well, we've got one object that might give us a little bit of a clue, and that's this shale spindle wool, which is Roman in date as well. And this would have been used to make wool thread. So we might have some evidence of cloth production here at the site.
Before becoming used as a spindle wool, that was a lathe core from the manufacture of shale vessels or armlets, bracelets. So we've got shale working industry as well. And given that we've also got the animal bone with the cut marks and the shale cutting board, it's feasible that it was used in craft activities, leather working, that kind of thing. It doesn't have to be domestic eating. cooking preparation.
So, the Duatrigas probably lived here for centuries, adapting to the societal changes around them. But apart from the Roman postholes, we found very little evidence of the buildings where they might have lived.
What about the round house?
So the supposed kind of ring ditch is supposed to be here and run around to that side with the house being on that side. However, I don't think we have enough evidence to say that this is any kind of roundhouse.
It's not very ringy or ditchy, is it?
No, and there's not much other evidence that suggests roundhouse at the moment. There's no post holes, there's not a lot of domestic material.
So I'm wondering if the function of this is therefore different. Maybe it's more like an additional stock enclosure or some different purpose to whatever's going on in there. So that's really cool.
Yeah.
Stuart has completed his survey and thinks that our site is part of a network supporting a series of Roman villas.
As well as the fields, we've also got a spring here. You can see this valley coming down here and coming into the main Corfe Valley. You've got a spring with water coming down right past our site, which of course is going to provide water for animals and stock, importantly. Yeah. This big natural gap in here that's starting to develop, it's like an early version of this, isn't it? This is the only access up onto the ridge to this field system. So we're able to link these field systems with these and our settlement,
Nice, isn't it? And so what we're seeing is a really well-placed position site. You can understand why our Iron Age settlers were here.
As the Roman influence grew, a number of villas sprang up, bounded by the natural geography, which divided the land into portions, each estate with water, fertile land, and pasture.
That industry that we're seeing, particularly in the later phases of Trench 4, which is very deep, with lots of Roman stuff at the top, could that be the people creating, using the resources and creating material for the villa?
I think there is a common unit in all here. Green Island, you know, there's evidence of shale working. Mm-hmm. There's evidence of shale working from this villa next to our site.
There's evidence of shale working on our site.
And there's evidence of shale working here down at Bucknell. And down here off the map, we have big source of
Kimmeridge.
So that's the common factor. So roots will have come through here, out across the dry land, and the benign route is sort of like that, and then products can go out by sea and stuff can come in and then can come back along. Our site is perfectly positioned to exploit that shale trade.
The theory is that industrial black earth in the trenches could be masking earlier Iron Age dwellings.
There's something there, isn't there?
Yeah.
And in Trench 1, under the post pads, we might have a ring ditch. Derek's kiln theory is looking good because Rachel now thinks that the defects in the late Roman pottery she was so excited about on day one suggest it was waste of pottery discarded after firing.
Because we are getting some more grain and some more charcoal, but it's not pouring out in the same way that I thought it would. For example, if it was like a crop drying kiln or something.
So it seems that this furnace probably was a kiln after all. In the last hour of the dig, Jackie and John have got a bit of a plot twist in Trench 1.
We've gone through the Iron Age horizon where we had those post pipes going down that were packed at the top. Yep. And we have got a feature here. It isn't as we thought. We might have some more graves, but this doesn't look like a grave.
No, it's definitely something. It's linear in form, it's got a bit of a curve to it.
And you've got that rounded end, haven't you?
Rounded end there. It's possibly continuing to something here.
Yeah, over there, yeah.
It might be a fragment of roundhouse gully. It's potentially the earliest feature in the trench, so definitely worthy of investigation.
Yeah.
A roundhouse here would be just a few metres from where our two women were buried. But it's likely that it was here sometime before they were alive.
Feels like things are coming to a wind down, Derek.
I know, we've come back to where it's all began, and we finally end of day three understanding this trench. We've got a round house ring ditch down here, which is probably associated with the banjo enclosure itself. So we've got that lovely early late mid to late Iron Age phase. We got some wasters out of the kiln, which finally...
don't sound too smug.
I don't need to eat my own hat there. And we've got lots and lots more industrial debris coming out of the features we're just finishing up. So that taste of industry, that flavour of industry is carrying on.
As the day draws to a close, Hilda's just seen the faintest shadow of a ring ditch, possibly around an Iron Age shack or an animal enclosure. And in Matt's trench, the rain has made it really tough to see the two sides of the funnel into the banjo.
I think that in later periods, this part of the banjo ditch, this part of the enclosure, is delineating the kind of heavy, dirty industrial side from the slightly less intensely used side, which is why Hilda's trench is so clean, whereas everything we see in this direction is quite mucky, dark soil, all this ashy, dark material.
That makes sense. I can believe that a lot. And obviously, this trench was about finding the entrance to the banjo enclosure, which we didn't quite get. We didn't find the return ditch at the other end. But as a theory, that works really nicely.
After the dig, further investigation revealed that the ditch on the other side of the funnel could have been filled in during the Roman period, when it's possible the enclosure was remodeled to incorporate a series of workshops in Trench 5.
Chris and James have taken out two of the ditch slots, and Chris's one's got actually five ditches interlinked, intercutting each other. It's a lot to interpret. This is where we got the slag from as well.
Yeah, we had that lovely piece of slag, didn't we?
Yeah, but still a few questions. It's not fully sorted out. Just in the middle there, you can see the clay slab that Mike's put a slot through to try and understand. And underneath that, we had the shale core.
Oh, from the armlet. So, yeah. So it might be shale working.
Yeah, that would be an absolute treat.
As the storm clouds build again, Mars's team in Trench 4 are still trying to get through centuries of Roman activity to find the Iron Age origins.
We've got a trench and a half, mate.
It is. I mean, it's a monster, isn't it? But we've got just a ridiculous amount of deposit of this dark soil that we're seeing, and a lot of this area at the top of the field. We've got late Roman at the top, possibly industrial activity going on, and then so we went a lot lower down to try and find the Iron Age, and we found more Roman tiles.
I was hoping for a really nice, coherent story. Nice Iron Age, then a big deposit, then some Roman stuff on top, but it's a mix, isn't it? And this black earth has been kind of plaguing us throughout the dig, what it's caused by, where it comes from, why it's filling up so much space on the site. I mean, we've had 500 years of occupation on this site, so we've had 500 winters. We've had 500 years of people warming their homes, using turf as a fuel that gives lots of earthy, ashy remnants. On top of that, we do know we've had industry, we've had iron production, we've had ceramic production, we've had agricultural production, all of which use fuel and create more and more of this black earth. So I think that black earth isn't a problem. I think it's a sign of life. I think where we're finding these deposits, we're finding inhabitation, activity, people. That's what we want.
Yeah, and that's a really nice way of looking at it. And whilst this is a monster, it gives us a really nice insight into that, doesn't it?
At the end of our investigations, we believe that the two Duotritian women that brought us here lived inside a deep ditched banjo-esque enclosure that had been originally dug in the Middle Iron Age. If this is the case, it's the most southerly to have been identified. Around the time of the Roman invasion, the enclosure began to evolve from a farming community to a more industrial settlement as it became integrated into the villa economy.
It's a dream site for me, and it's a period I've always been absolutely fascinated in. How do people go from being late Iron Age peoples into Romano-British peoples? And in the textbooks, it can be quite cut and dry. Oh, you're in the Iron Age, and then you're in the Romano-British period. But of course, on the ground in people's lives, it's one generation after another. It's a much more gradual transition. Yeah. And ultimately ending up in what it looks like here as kind of a villa estate type scenario, where there's a slightly more well-heeled individual living just down the road, but here we've got this kind of
dirty agro-industry type landscape with a bit of agriculture, a bit of industrial production, and maybe even connected to a market just over there on the site next door. So it's become a really interesting story of the people on the ground.
I mean, this feels like it's an important story that needs to be told. I mean, will you be continuing with this work?
Yeah, this is the beginning, not the end. And it's moved the research forward in leaps and bounds, but there's so many more questions to answer. And I almost want to just keep digging. I know the 3 days are up, but I'd love to just keep digging and keep learning about these people and try and piece together this really interesting and dynamic community.
Over the last 3 days, we've trodden in the footsteps of the Duatrigas, who lived and worked in the foothills of this awe-inspiring landscape. The settlement evolved over centuries, and the industrial activity enriched the soil to create the fertile farmland Derek's family have been farming. But as we decamp, the team is given a small insight into how it might have been to live here in years gone by, at the mercy of the elements.
We've got to find a tent. And mine was full of water when I went back to it just now.
Join Time Team on Patreon to access exclusive 3D models, masterclasses, and behind-the-scenes insights.